It is identical in functionality to the blocking socket chat program, but now uses non-blocking sockets. And it's the text protocol version that has been ported to non-blocking sockets. Why not the serialized object version? Well, because to serialize an object, we need object input and output streams, so it would have made it stream-based again. Of course, we could have serialized the object to a buffer in memory using an object output stream and then sent the content of that buffer. But to keep it slightly simpler and avoid streams, I choose to use the text protocol version. The classes are to a big extent quite similar, apart from the actual network communication. So remember, there were two problems that should be solved from the blocking socket example. Problem number one was that a thread, after having received a message from a client, so this is the message sent over, this is the network, it arrives at the socket, and then that thread would turn around and broadcast the message back to the same client, but also to all other connected clients. These are the sockets, and it would be sent over the net to all those clients. So this was the blocking socket example, and it meant that this thread was blocked during all sendings. While it was sending to all clients, it could not receive from a new message from its own client. So that could potentially be a problem if there were many clients, or if clients were slow or whatever. But that problem has been solved in this non-blocking socket version. For thread usage in the non-blocking socket program, you should look at the video on that subject. I will not explain it again here. But the important thing is that now there is no blocking send at all, so this scenario cannot appear. Actually, this thread will just submit the message for broadcasting, but it will not actually wait for the sending to complete. Okay, but you should look at the video on thread usage with non-blocking sockets to understand this better. That was the first problem that was fixed. The second problem was the length header. The non-blocking socket example was a bit oversimplistic. It had no length header. We just assumed that the entire message arrived at the same time, when no half messages were ever read. And it worked, since it was a very small program with very few clients running on local host, so it was a very protected environment. But in reality, we should always have a length header, and now in this program, the length header has been added. So each message starts with the number of bytes the message contains, for example, 52. After that comes three hash signs, which is the length header delimiter, and then follows the message, which is identical to the messages in the blocking socket example. Okay, so both those two problems have been solved. So let's first look at the client side. So the client side is in this packages here. First thing to note is that there is no controller now. The only reason to use the controller for the blocking socket program turned out to be that it handled threading, submission to thread pools. But here there is no such thing. We have one dedicated thread handling all network communication. We do not submit network communication tasks to a thread pool. So therefore there was no need of the controller here, and it has been removed. Apart from that, the code is quite similar, of course, except for the actual network communication. There are some changes to the view, but they are not very big, so I will not go through them. Perhaps I should mention that the output handler of the blocking socket example has now been replaced by a communication listener, which has some more methods. So there are different methods for different network-related events. And this was the observer interface that is called whenever something happens at the network level. And the implementing class is in the view and informs the user about what happened, as was the case also in the blocking socket example. Also, due to the length header, there is a new common class in the common package, this message splitter thing, which handles all the string manipulation, receiving partial messages, and so on. So there's a static method, prepend length header, which just prepends the length header, and it should be used when sending a message. Then this class maintains a string with all received characters, just keep appending strings as they arrive over the network. So whenever a string is received, it's passed to the append received string method, which calls extract message, trying to extract messages. Whenever the correct number of bytes have been received, a complete message is received, and that message is then added to the queue of a complete received messages. Okay, but I will not dive deeper into the details of the string manipulation there. That leaves us with the actual communication then, which is done in server connection. So let's have a look at that one. The first method that is called is connect, when we want to establish a connection. This method will just set the server address to the specified address, the address we are connecting to, and then start this thread. So this class actually implements runnable, and therefore we can create a thread running its run method. So it starts in the run method and immediately executes init connection and init selector. So let's look at those. So init connection opens the socket channel, sets it to be non-blocking, and then connects to the specified address. Init selector creates the selector and registers interest in the connect event. So we will be notified when a connect operation is finished. Okay, so the connected flag is true, so we enter the run loop. All this is the run loop of this thread. It's not time to send, we are not sending anything. This flag is false. So we come here and call select, which is where the execution blocks. So select will not return until any of the registered interests can be performed without blocking. And we have only one interest so far, and that was connection. So the execution will block on this line until connection is established. So when select returns, connection is established. And then we come here, call selected keys, which returns all the keys whose interests can be performed immediately without blocking. At this stage, it means we are connected. Okay, so we remove this key from the set operations we are interested in, because it has been performed now. The key is valid until it is cancelled, and we are not cancelling anything at this stage. We will come there later on in the program. So for now, execution just continues, and is connectable will return true, because that's the only thing we are interested in, connection. So then we call the method complete connection, and finish connect, which now can be performed without blocking since the connection is established. Then we change interest. We are now interested in reading. After having connected, we want to read something from the server. We are expecting the existing conversation from the server. Okay, then it's time to notify the user that connection has been established. That is done in the method notifyConnection, and we try to get the address from the socket channel that we are connected to. If that fails, we use the address that the user specified. Okay, let's have a brief look at notifyConnection. This includes IO, because we're going to print to the screen. And IO should not be handled on the network thread. So a new thread is spawned here from the fork join pool, built-in thread pool. What do? We just iterate over all registered communication listeners and call connect on those. And remember, the communication listener was the interface that was used for notifying the user about network-related things, in this case connected. So let's see where that communication listener is passed to the server connection object. It is in the method addCommunicationListener. So here the user interface passes a communication listener that should be used by this object to notify about connections and the sendings and the whatever received messages. Let's look at the non-blocking interpreter passing this thing to the server connection. It's here when the user has given the connect command. User interface passes a console output object to the server connection, and the console output object implements communication listener. Back to the server connection. Okay, so now connection is completed, we are done, and we are now interested in reading from the server. The complete connection method returns, and we go back to take a new turn in the loop, start over from here. And now we are interested in receiving something from the server. So the next time The selector returns. It means we are ready to receive, and is readable will return true, and we will call receive from server. So let's have a look at receive from server. There is a buffer message from server, which is a direct buffer created, and the object is constructed. It's here, a direct buffer, because it's created only once and used many times, so we might as well use a direct buffer. I don't know if we gain very much in this particular situation, but we shouldn't lose too much either. Actually, running the profiler shows that we do not lose anything. We do not spend much time in allocating this buffer. It's only done once, so what could be possibly be the problem? It's things that are done in loops that we should be afraid of. Back to receive from server. So we clear this buffer in order to be able to write to it. And then we read from the socket channel and write to the buffer. This is where the message is received. And remember that this is now non-blocking because the selector told us that we could call read on the channel without risking blocking. Okay, how many bytes did we read? If we read minus 1 bytes, it means that the other end, the server, has closed the connection and we threw an exception. But if it does not return minus 1, it means something was received. So then we extract that message that was received from the buffer here. So this is the code for getting the received string out of the buffer. Flip to enable writing, create a byte array that can contain the message, read the message from the buffer to the newly created bytes array, and then return a string containing those bytes. We have extracted the received string, then call message splitter that was explained previously in this video. Pass received string to the message splitter, which will append this received string to previously received strings, and from the entire concatenated string will extract complete messages. Check if there are any complete messages in the message splitter, and if so, extract the next message. Then it's time to handle that message, and we are only expecting messages of type broadcast. So if we receive another type of message, it's something went wrong and we throw an exception. But if we did receive a broadcast message, it means the server sent us something, and we show that message to the user by calling the appropriate method in the communication listener. That's done here. Again, this will result in I/O, so we submit it to the four-join pool, the built-in thread pool, and then iterate over all listeners. There is actually only one. In that listener, call the received message method, which is supposed to be called when the broadcast message has been received from the server. We can also see what actually happens. Remember, console output was the implementation of the communication listener interface, and in the received message, it's printed to the console, which just is print out. Right, so that was receiving a message from the server. Last, let's look at sending a message to the server. I will go through this with the help of the debugger. And I place the breakpoint in the sendChatEntry method, which is where we enter server connection when sending an entry in the chat communication. Okay, the debugger is already started, so and I've started a client here as well. So let's send a message, and we arrive at the breakpoint, and we can see that the string here is the message "Hi." Let's enter the sendMSG method. So now we use the string joiner to create the message, and we prepend the entry message type to the message. So let's do that. Now let's have a look at the message with the message type prepended by calling joiner.toString. Here we can see the message. It's hi, and the message type is entry, and there are two hashtags to separate the message type from the actual message body. Fine, let's continue. So next thing is to prepend the message header. Okay, now we can see the message here. So now the header is prepended. There were 9 bytes in this message. Now we have created the entire string that shall be sent. Next thing is to wrap it in a byte buffer and add it to the queue of messages that shall be sent. So the wrapping is done here, And the queue of messages is messages to send, so we'll do that. Okay, done. And then we set the time to send flag to true, and finally call the wake up on the selector, because we must inform the selector that now there is something in this queue. The selector is only waiting on the sockets, has nothing to do with the queue. So therefore we have to manually wake the selector here. Okay, so let's place a breakpoint in the socket handling thread here after select. This thread is currently blocking on the select statement here. Okay, now let's continue. So now we switched thread. The user interface thread, the one we were originally following, now has deposited the message in the queue of messages that shall be sent, and then woke up as we saw the communication thread that was blocked on select call. So now we are in the communication thread, and let's see what happens here. First we get the set of selected keys. This is the set of selected keys, and we are interested in the send operation. Let's continue. We remove this key from the set of ready keys, should not handle it again. It's valid, it's not connectable, it's not readable, but it is writable. So, okay, enter the send to server method where we will send. Here we will extract the first message from the queue of messages to send. Let's see if there is such a message. There was, otherwise, this peak call that extracts the first message would have returned null. Okay, now it's time for the actual writing. And now we know that we can write without blocking. That was the purpose of the selector, right? So we write. Okay, then did we write everything? We have to check. Maybe we just wrote part of the buffer. If we wrote just part of the buffer, we return. That's the following line here. Because if it could not write the entire buffer, no point in continuing it. It's not okay to send at the moment. So then we just return. And later, again, we'll be informed by the selector when it's possible to continue sending. And then we again come here and write the remaining parts of the buffer. And we can know it, we will not write the entire buffer again, because the buffer keeps its pointers, right? The position does not change, so it continues sending where it stopped last time. Okay, so let's see. But now we managed to send everything, so then the entire message is sent, and we can remove it from the queue of messages to send. There was nothing more to send. There could have been more messages in the queue. We tried to send all of them, but there were not. So we are done sending, and now we return the interest to read. We are interested in reading because we're done sending. Okay, so that was how message is sent from client to server, and that concludes client-side code.